Hey, remember that time that I was in Detroit and you talked a bunch of shit about me with Jeff because you thought I wasn't watching the show? I brought a new host.
Hey.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to episode 45 of A Brew With You. I am one of your hosts, Blake Mickle, accompanied by, he does listen to everything, Danny Brajas.
I literally hear everything.
I hear all. That was a Simpsons reference. That was a Kodos.
Yes.
Remember, it was on the Jerry Springer show.
Don't blame me. I voted for Kodos.
Go ahead. Throw your vote away.
See, we've got, oh my gosh, we're going to have a fun show. We got another guy who knows Simpsons reference.
Too many.
The Pokemon master himself, Andrew Wu. How are you, sir? Welcome.
Good.
Special guest host.
I'm applauding myself. Yes. This is how well I'm doing.
They have the audience applauding, too. They're clapping at home. They're at their screen. They're at work standing for you.
Right.
I like to think that we just caused several car accidents with that introduction.
I can live with this. I can live with that weight.
Speaking of car accidents, I'm a... looking into purchasing a monthly subscription to either SoundCloud, Spotify, Apple Music, or YouTube Red. Started my research today, talked to some coworkers. I have one who has Apple Music, the other two have Spotify. I have no idea yet. The one I'm leaning towards right now is YouTube Red. Why? I'm a big YouTuber. I'm on YouTube.
Sure.
I like the fact that I could play a video and like go back to my apps and the video will still play. The audio will still play.
Yes, that is nice.
In addition, I still have access to a giant music library like Apple Music and Spotify. That's my reasoning right now. It's like I'm getting like the same price, but I'm getting the video perks with it too. Don't know yet though, because Spotify is kind of the king. Apple Music is, you know, good quality. And SoundCloud, I'm also on SoundCloud, but I think I'm turning away from that just because it's the most expensive.
Okay.
Yep. Thoughts, opinions, stream music at all, gentlemen?
I have Apple Music. I'm going to be honest, I don't use it a ton. I have used it for the purposes of the fact that I pay for it, so I can just kind of create and make playlists of anything that I want.
Okay.
I actually have been using Spotify quite a lot more.
Do you have both subscriptions?
I don't have a subscription. I have Spotify free, and I'm still using that more than I'm using that Apple Music.
That's the thing. I don't understand Spotify and the free version. Like, I don't know how I could play songs. If I'm like, I like this artist, and I play this artist, and then it becomes a shuffle or something like that. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You got to trust the robot. The robot's going to tell you, hey, this is what you want to listen to right now.
Yes.
All right, move it a little bit closer. It's good.
No,
you're good. Trust the robot. I like Pandora. I do like Pandora, but you can do a subscription with Pandora. I actually just thought about that now. Could you pick songs as you go? Like, pick the song you want to play on Pandora, or is it just no ads?
I'm not 100% certain, but I think it's just no ads, which I think is why Spotify is king, because if you pay for it, you can download certain songs and just play that same song over and over if you want to without having the shuffle play.
See, I like that.
You can also skip unlimited, which is another Pandora paid for perk. But I think on both as well, you can also replay. Like, you can just go back a couple of songs like that have played.
Okay. I also like Spotify's a big perk too, because you can sync it up with like your computer, your PlayStation. So it's like you're listening on your phone, you come home on your computer, and it's like pick up right where you left off sort of thing on the song, or it'll know like the last, your history or something like that. I'm like, that sounds pretty cool too.
Right.
I don't know. You listen to music?
I'm barely a music guy, but I will say Google Play Music is a thing that exists.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I personally love Google, and Google personally loves me back.
Do they?
So
they
send me an email every time I get an email. It says Google right on it. I know that they care.
It's like a little heart with a W and a G in it.
Right. Forever and ever and ever. No, but I mean, the nicest thing, I don't use it for any subscription kind of things, but I do have like my entire MP3 collection from... the last time I listened to music was probably like mid-college.
Oh, damn.
So it's a lot of the White Stripes.
Hell yeah.
You can pick any song that you own already out, and it's straightforward.
Yeah.
Listen to this on repeat forever.
To go back what I said, the YouTube Red is actually, it's Google Play, unlimited Google Play. It's like a package deal.
Oh,
so it's like Google Play and YouTube Red But if you purchase YouTube, it's like the same. So you have to you technically have to download the like YouTube Music app on your phone. I'm still looking into
it. Does Google Play include just music, or does it also include any movies?
I'm looking into it.
Because I know Google Play, like, you can also use Google Play to stream movies.
Yeah. And the problem is, I have, you know, I got an iPhone, so it's that puts a hindrance on it because it's
Google
not
Android. Google loves the iPhone. Google loves the iPhone.
Well, I love. I use the Chrome app. I got the Drive app. I've got the
Gboard.
The Gboard's amazing.
Gboard is great.
It's like best gift machine ever, man. For any of you joining us for the very first time, A Brew With You is where Danny and I will try a beer, and sometimes a special guest will try a beer for the very first time while discussing random topics, broken up Tuesday through Thursday on YouTube, with the whole episode being released on Friday. You can get this entire episode a week early if you go to patreon.com/bigdealblake, along with your extra content, exclusive perks and rewards and all that good stuff.
Tons of perks.
That's right. How it works? Well, let's see. We got a special guest. So, special guest comes. They never bring the beer. So, I provided the beer today. And we have a special guest. So, the special guest, Andrew Wu, where are we drinking today?
Today, we are drinking in the fine, fine city of Milwaukee. The main reason we are drinking in Milwaukee is because I did not get arrested in Milwaukee this weekend.
Oh, God. We have to talk about this. Yeah. I saw your Facebook post. Yes. That was so funny. So we're tipping the old hat to Milwaukee, eh?
I happen to love Milwaukee.
I've never been.
It's beautiful.
Actually.
It's beautiful.
It was so funny. I was supposed to go 2 weeks ago. I'm not a big baseball guy, but Cubs were playing Milwaukee. Hour and a half drive.
Yeah, it's not bad.
And, great stadium.
It was raining, but then I realized it can be an indoor stadium, but it was still kind of a shitty drive. And I'm like, it's all right. There's 162 games out of the year. It's all right.
Sure.
So Milwaukee on three, gentlemen.
Yeah, I mean, unless you have anything else specific that you want to yell to make Milwaukee appear.
I don't know what
Bucks.
Is there. Bucks go
Milwaukee
Brewer Town. Milwaukee.
Milwaukee. Milwaukee on three. I like that. Okay, Milwaukee on three. One, two, three. Milwaukee. A.
It's a Wayne's World reference.
That's right.
You youngins.
Alice Cooper.
I'm from Delaware.
Now we're in Delaware.
Yes. All right. Let's. We've been talking for a little bit. So today I brought the beer.
Sure.
Danny is. You know, he's gotten all this training and all this research he's done in Detroit, which is Danny's back.
Danny's back. Back again. Detroit versus everybody.
That's right. Yeah. You know, when I go to get the beer now, you know, Danny brought this up one time. It's a little tricky now because we've done 45 episodes right now. It's 45 different beers we've gone through. That's a lot of beer.
Sure.
Still, there's infinite amount of beer out there right now. But still, sometimes...
It's always seasonal stuff.
Exactly. So I just saw this. There was three of them on the road. There was Green Flash Tangerine, a standard IPA, and a passion fruit. The passion fruit didn't catch my eye. I was going towards it first, and I looked into it a little bit more, and I said, I don't think I've ever had a tangerine beer. Never even heard of Green Flash, even better. So what the hell? So Danny, you did some research. What do you got for us?
So Green Flash is a brewery out of San Diego. It's a tangerine style IPA. What do we realize about today is that it's a very popular trend to add fruit adjuncts into IPAs for additional flavor to kind of accent what the hop characteristics of the beer traditionally do. This is going to be interesting. Traditionally, with West Coast IPAs, IPAs that are brewed out west, you'll often find that they tend to be hop heavy, a lot more bitter on the finish, a lot less malty sweetness to kind of balance out that hop bitterness.
Mm-hmm.
This one having tangerine,
California, by the way, right?
Right. Yeah. This one having tangerine in it should be interesting.
San Diego.
Green Flash has been around for a while, but they just recently kind of did like a whole label and style overhaul. So they've come out with a lot of like kind of different stuff, a different twist on a lot of their classic beers. So this should be an interesting drink. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, the description here really doesn't say anything. It's just a bunch of propaganda. Nothing really about the beer itself. Tangerine zest carries throughout, accessed by bright floral tropical flavors and a juicy finish. brewed with American malts and blend with a Citra and Cascade hops. This is a beautiful brew to behold.
It says Tangerine Paradise. I don't need to read anymore.
Wow.
A refreshing.
You're a tangerine man, Will?
A refreshing Tangerine Paradise.
I will eat every tangerine in the world until there are now, none left.
And again, like I said, you know, traditionally a West Coast style is going to be a lot more hop heavy. At 75 IBUs, that's pretty up there. So I would still expect a pretty bitter finish on this beer based off of numbers and what science traditionally would tell me. But again, I've never had this before, so...
See, and that's exciting, I think, because that's why I like the show so much, because we don't talk about beer for an hour and 15 minutes. Yeah. We try something new, which is I love just trying new things. I went to a new restaurant last night, Little Bad Wolf up North Chicago there, in the Ravenswood area.
Okay.
I would recommend the Mussels. Fantastic. So that's a big thing. It's exciting to try something new. And we just like beer because Danny likes his beer a lot. And I do too. And Danny, you know, has a kind of a job. Right? And you like beer. Every time we hung out, we get a beer.
Who doesn't like beer? What kind of communists are out there?
This is America. Yeah,
come
okay?
on.
San Diego, come California, on. America.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I was thinking about this, Danny. You know, a thing to change for the show. A little, not change, but add.
Okay.
A cheers every time. What do we cheers to every time we do this show? I don't know. I'm just putting this on the spot.
Sure.
We get on the spot. Like, so we have a new cheers every time we do this. We just say cheers Nostrovia, our
right.
regular rigmarole there. But I don't know if we want to do a cheers. You have anyone thinking having something to mind right now? Mm. Let's see. How about to music?
Music?
To music. Yeah. Because I'm trying to find a music. So to... Hope, yeah, this is to hope we find a band or a song that just hits us right now and we're just making it feel good. Songs you want to sing in the shower.
Sure.
All right, let's sing. Mm. So sing it in the shower. Oh, yeah. Mm.
No, I got nothing. I'm working on it.
I'm still like Elvis in the shower, but that's just me.
Yeah.
Oh, I got 1 week, Bare Naked Ladies, because I got to get all the words in and they got to fit and it's impossible.
Bare Naked Ladies, they were big, man.
Oh, Canada's finest. Canada's finest.
I think so. Not too many Canada bands out there. Let's Nostrovia. So to music, to the new song.
To music.
Nostrovia.
To music.
Yes. Mm-hmm. That is tangerine-y, all right.
Oh, it's very tangerine-y.
Oh, but it's got that... definitely has the IPA with it too.
Interesting. Yeah,
that's I like. See, then
it blends.
That
well.
Is what I love. People, I've said this a million times on the show. It's like when it says tangerine soul style IPA, it's like tangerine IPA. That's what I'm tasting.
Yeah,
strong though. Dane's really processing right now. This is where I do a lot of filler while he processes the right words.
Yeah, no.
This is where Karate Kid.
Later, we come back in.
It's meditating the entire time.
Take your time.
If you guys watch carefully, I actually do levitate a little during every show after the first sip. That's pretty much it. It's kind of on the nose of what I expected. At 75 IBUs, that is a very bitter on the finish. That is like.
Extremely bitter.
I feel like even though I initially got punched in the mouth with you know a the tangerine bits. And there was it just tasted like somebody squeezed a fresh orange in my mouth.
Yep.
At the tail end, that fresh orange just turned into a pine cone, and I was just like, whoa.
You know what? When you said pine cone, you know what I was just thinking? It was really close, like the pine needles. Like, you know that when you get like a little snap, that pine sap.
Absolutely.
That's what I'm getting at.
Yeah.
Like why are you guys eating pine cones? I don't understand.
It's a Midwest thing. I don't know.
Like the crunch?
I don't know. We're born in the, not born, we were from the western suburbs of Chicago. It's weird. That's why we left and we live in the city now.
Yeah.
You know, where are you from originally?
Southwest suburbs. I'm from Oak Forest.
Oak Forest, right? You know there's Oak Park.
It's not Oak Park. It's not Park Forest.
Right.
It's not Forest Park. It's still not Oak Park.
And you still didn't eat pine when you growing up.
Of course not. Okay. We were in Oak Forest. Okay, that's
so
crazy.
You were eating oak.
Oak.
Yeah. Of course.
Yeah. Got it. See, that makes more sense.
It makes for a very sturdy base.
If you don't know, ladies and gentlemen, if you're not familiar with the show, we rate the beer at the end of the podcast at a 1 through 5 star rating. It's actually a 10-point scale if you want to get technical. 10-point scale, but 5 star rating. So Wu, who are you? Who's Andrew Wu?
Who am I?
Who is this man? This man of mystery. This man of Metroid.
This is a serious question that I ask myself on a nearly daily basis.
You are not your job.
It is
your job.
No, that is a pretty serious thing. I don't know. I like to think I'm fun. Pretty easygoing guy, right?
Yeah, I'll give you a back. Yeah. How Andrew and I, I'm saying Andrew. I'm going back and forth calling you Andrew and Will.
It's the same. Like, in my head, I call myself Batman, so it's fine. Yeah. It's fine. Yeah.
So no matter what you're saying, he's just hearing Batman.
Batman, 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 Batman.
help me. It's just like, it's like, so where are you from? And then you're hearing, you're saying like, save me, Batman. I'm tired. Save me. What?
No, like, you know, I don't know. Like, so, you know, together, we took improv classes together, That's how we met. And
at I.O. Chicago.
Oh, but formerly Improv Olympic.
Yes. Yeah. That was actually in the, I prefer the older, I like the older location better, personally.
Oh, yeah. The Wrigleyville place? Yeah. There was something like grody and seedy and disgusting and amazing about that place. Yeah. You know, no, that's what it's supposed to be. Now it's so clean.
It's supposed to be like, seedy and disgusting?
Yes. This
not
is what,
piney, Danny. Gosh.
Yeah, no more pines.
Not for the pine.
No more pines. It's supposed to need, like, I feel like a good improv show makes you feeling like something just hit me and like rubbed me in oil and like, I don't know what's
in
going
a good
on.
Way though. You feel it's right. like a naughty dirty but comedy. Well, what I liked about the old ones, just simply put, is that because it was a smaller theater, it's more intimate, you know, and the audience is right up there. And now we have this newer theater has, you know, they're bigger theaters and
it's kind of a machine. Right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's more it feels less personal. I mean, I feel it's like colder when I go there, but I was just there for the first time in a while. So Cook County.
Yeah.
So anywho, we met doing improv and that's what I've said on the show. A lot of these guests I have, I met through comedy or improv. Yep. And the best thing is a lot of these people aren't in comedy. It's like, that's the power of
most of us are comedy rejects.
pretty much.
They looked at you and they said, no, you are not the funny one. So.
I need a redhead. What color hair do you have, Blake? Oh, that's right. Not funny color.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a common fact that redheads are hilarious.
Oh.
It's Carrot Top, baby.
Every single redhead is on television or the radio. It's a fact.
Well, what's the one Tina Fey produced show, the woman? She's
a
redhead.
You guys watch Game of Thrones? Did you see how hilarious Sophie Turner was?
I'm dying.
Andy Grit. Don't forget Ygritte. Yeah.
The Red Witch.
Oh, yeah.
She's redhead, right? Yeah, she's
Melisandre. Yeah.
What's,
provided tons of comic relief.
I just lost my train of thought. We're talking about comedy, redheads.
You mentioned Kimmy Schmidt.
Oh, thank you. Kimmy Schmidt. That's the one I was thinking. Thank you. Yeah. Totally. You got my back there. Kimmy Schmidt. That's a red who's in comedy.
Yeah.
I don't know many reds in comedy. There's not many reds, though. I heard it's a mutation.
Oh, yeah.
It's actually a genetic mutation.
They're the freaks. I mean, we're all...
Southpaw calls them, you know, the ginger... They're the spawn of Satan. I love that episode, by the way. South Park's the best. I know we want to fix the facts in a minute here, but I just want to get a background to you, Wu. So, you know, we met through comedy, but that's not at all what we do for a living. Well, if you find this podcast hilarious, I am doing it. And please support the show. Patreon.com/BigDealBlake, you know, support the show. Thank you very much. Thank you, patrons. I actually got a new patron this month. Thank you, patrons. And I love you.
In a good way.
In a way. Yeah. In a non-ginger way.
In a consensual way.
So what else do you do? What's one of your tools of trade?
So my big thing is I'm a software engineer, right? So I make mobile games for old people. So not like specifically, but they're slot machines. So.
I love pachinko.
Yeah. It's essentially like, hey, I want to hit a button and spend money on. We're like a Candy Crush.
Don't mean to call you out right now, but my godmother plays the shit out of those games.
She's our favorite customer.
Oh, she plays it constantly, like fake money and just
no.
Just
I mean,
spin.
Yeah, they love it. So it's that's what we make.
You see the dials turn.
Yeah, like little buttons, lots of sound, lots of.
Do you work for Konami? Is that why you're doing all the pachinko machines?
I do not work for Konami. We do work with Konami. We do work.
Shut up! Really?
Like, well, everybody like works together. It's actually a really small industry.
Okay.
Like, there are only a handful of companies, so kind of all.
And
talk
I don't want
to
like reveal a lot. Just to get a general idea. I know because you know people. We've had like a sociologist on here, and it's like obviously you can't really talk too much about his profession.
Let me tell you about all of my worst patients.
Let's talk about every bad app, every person who screws up my job, my life.
Let me forego the Hippocratic Oath and tell you guys everything.
First, harm. Software dev. It's fun. I like making games. Is fun. Even
I've never really
thought of it as making games, but we make games. That's
great.
That's what we do.
Is it? Is it pretty much what you're doing? Is coding like just coding? What's your language you use?
So I make stuff in Unity, which is great for also game dev. Unity's a game engine. So I'm trying to think of what a big thing that's come out. You've seen it. Like if you've played any games on PC, especially, you've seen Unity.
Oh, cool. I bet you if you need a couple, I would probably get at least. See, that's the thing now in my older age. I don't game as much, but I know so much what's going on with the game industry.
I've convinced myself. I've convinced myself that it's research. So
yep.
Yeah. I just spent 6 hours researching.
I'm researching by having this controller in my hand.
I'm studying because I nap on this couch a little.
You need to eat some Doritos while I'm researching. Slurpees.
Yeah, sure. Researching a diet.
Everybody knows that proper research requires research fuel.
Science.
Can't argue with science. Yeah.
So you've been doing this for how long now?
I just crossed 4 years at this company.
Woo. Yeah. That's right. One of the last times we had dinner, it was a couple of years ago, and you were with that company still. Yeah.
Yeah. They've been good to me. So.
You are showcasing longevity.
Yeah. This is it's crazy, right? That this is a long time, right? That this is
4 years. That's getting there. Yeah. That's like getting to long time now. Yeah.
I have spent the better part of my last couple of weeks just looking at resumes and interviewing people and. That's not bad. Like if you're at a company for 4 years, that's great. That's like, oh man.
Yeah.
So I get people who are at companies for like 2 years, 3 years, you know, a year, they're looking for something new. And then I get somebody whose resume is like, I've been with this company for 3 months, 12 different companies for 3 months at a time.
See, that looks bad.
It looks terrible. Yeah.
It looks like you're looking for money. Like in my experience, it doesn't mean you're bad. It just means that I don't expect you to stick around.
We had a topic some time ago, job interviews. That was Danny's topic, and it was that was a while ago, but I'm doing a lot of reminiscing because of the 1 year anniversary episodes coming up in about a month or two here. So getting ready for that, doing some research. Again, patrons, if you got ideas or things you want to see for that 1 year episode, let us know. Patreon.com/BigDoubleBlake.
Party hats are required.
Okay.
Just so you know. Yeah.
Safari hat, maybe. I'm saying safari hat because I have one. A cowboy hat I have.
Sure.
Fedora. Baseball cap. Yeah. I haven't. When's the last time you wore a baseball cap?
I still wear them pretty regularly.
Regularly? Really?
Yeah.
Messes up the hair, man.
A lot of the times, like in the mornings, if I don't feel like showering or doing something before I go like to the store or something, I'll just throw in a hat.
Nice.
Okay.
Entire time that I was in the kitchen for 60 weeks, which we talked about last episode, I wasn't wearing a hairnet. I was wearing a baseball hat.
All right. You got to look cool, right?
Is that health code? That health code approved? Like hats cool?
Yeah.
Okay.
Surprisingly enough, yes.
I would say it covers about 90 to 95% of your head, right? Mm. I mean, or more.
Is it like a balaclava?
Especially for people with short hair.
Like, yeah. Sure.
Yeah.
Danny.
Blake.
Let's fix some facts and air some errors.
Oh, there's so many.
Oh my God. Being called out. So what are the last two episodes?
We're a bit behind. We're on the last two episodes. So obviously, the last episode I told you all about my computer problems and why I couldn't do my research properly.
Sure. But time out. This is yours and mine episode, last one, and then Jeff's and
mine. This is 43 and 44.
Got it.
Yes.
Just confirming for the fans.
Sure. And for Jeff Stewart specifically.
Oh.
So that he knows that he got things wrong.
Don't take his spot, Jeffy. You can't take the real host's spot. Thank you, Jeff, for being a guest host. It was really appreciative. You can't take his spot, Jeff. Thank you so much. That was a huge help. I really appreciate it.
Actually, I was giving Jeff X amount of shit there, but really, I mean, more often than not, he was way more accurate than you were in that episode. So,
God, calling me out. I just ran a half fucking marathon the day before that podcast. I just want to clarify.
Sure,
that.
My
brain was mush.
The facts don't care about your marathon. The facts are solid.
The fact was that I was tired.
The fact was that you need to handle the truth now.
All right, I don't know if I can handle
it. Jeff was 100% right. When you pour a beer, you should be looking at about an inch to an inch and a half of foam, i.e. head. That's carbon dioxide releasing from the beer. That gas is coming out of the beer. It's actually releasing a lot of the flavor characteristics of the beer. So a lot of the time, if you're getting poured a beer at a bar that has like anything less than that, either the bartender is pouring really wrong, there is something wrong with their CO2 system in the lines. There could be a separate issue with the keg where it's just way over its shelf life.
Got a free beer out of that two nights ago. The tag was up, so I got all this head, but I got a good chunk of beer, and they're like, I'm not going to charge you for this keg's tap. And I'm like, thanks, buddy.
Right. In inverse situations at the bottom of the barrel, or if the barrel's been really agitated, it can cause things to shake up. Mm-hmm. And there's different reasons where you can get a lot of foam in the line if there's air pockets in it. But more often than not, in a proper pour, you're looking for about an inch to an inch and a half. That is accurate. That's right. It's really funny, too, because a lot of the times people complain about,
they do.
Well, you didn't really fill up my beer. And it's like, Okay, but I poured it properly, right. But it's whatever.
There's air in the bag of chips. Yes. I didn't pay for the air. Right. I paid for the chips. Right. Yeah.
Perfect. I remember that.
Perfect coupling of an example. Perfect.
I have a story, but not now, because that's long. You can remind me about bag and air and chips later. So let's move on, because we're running long already.
Connie was on episode 28, just because you guys couldn't remember what episode she was on.
Quick clarification. Connie, showing some love.
Yeah. Wheat beers being unfiltered, a lot of them are. It's not an uncommon thing.
We're talking about the stupid wit.
Which I really want to try that myself now after hearing you guys talk about it.
I have to intervene right now. Yeah. I promise this. One of our patrons, I'll call him by his first name, Ryan, watched our episode. He's a very good patron and a great fan of the show. We'll have to have you on sometime because you're by far one of our best patrons, and I really appreciate that. He watched that episode and he had to bring a beer to a party, and just based off our suggestion, Stupid Wit, he took a picture of it and sent it to me. He's like, "Hey man, thanks for the episode. It was great." And he got a picture of Stupid Wit and he brought
awesome.
It.
That's so, awesome. Yeah. Nice.
Have to hear your take on that, Ryan, but, thanks again for supporting the show and, hope it worked out for you. We'll have to talk, see if you liked it or not, but still out there if you want to try it. Anywho,
we go forward. Because we didn't have exact dates, you guys talked about Dick Butkus. He played from 65 to 73.
I kind of right in that, right? I said late 60s, didn't I?
I think so.
I think I said 60s. Yeah. Okay. Well, we don't have to fix that, but anyway, we got the answer.
You had actually already covered the Three Flat Estates, so you guys were good with that. Machu Picchu is, in fact, in Peru, in the Andes. I couldn't find anything that said it was the second biggest, but it is the longest continental mountain range. The longest continental mountain range in the world. So I can confirm that it was the second highest, but it is definitely the longest.
Okay.
Moving on to episode 44, The Return of Me. Cats Up and Ketchup. Same thing, two different spellings of the identical product.
Got it. Enough said.
Yeah.
People, that's it. We don't have to go, we can go into bullshit thing. That's all you need to know. Like, that is something like a long going debate talking about the intricacies. What he just said, done. Finished. So, move on.
So Mr. Burns was right.
Ketchup. Casa.
So the only interesting thing about it, in the 1880s, I think it was, or maybe, Heinz, I'll fix that fact. Heinz was originally catsup. They switched over to ketchup to differentiate themselves from the rest of the market.
Makes sense.
And now, of course, they're like the most recognized name in ketchup or catsup.
Catsup?
Like the donut donut. You know, donut, D-O-U-G-H.
The dough nut.
But
dough
donut. Nut. Yeah.
Last but certainly not least, because I got to call out Jeff, I will now get to call out Connie because she responded to this on Patreon. She responded early.
Thank you for posting on Patreon, Connie, though. I really appreciate it, though.
Yes. But because I get to step on Jeff's toes and Blake's toes, I get to step on Connie's toes, too. I got it, Connie. I did the research. I understand that the John Cusack movie I was thinking of was One Crazy Summer.
The work, Connie. Don't give up.
He was also in an early movie called Hot Pursuit. So two movies relatively close in his early career that had Hot and Crazy Summer in it. So you can imagine where my confusion was with Wet Hot Crazy American Summer or whatever it was.
But I was right with it.
You were right. It was a much later movie, but that's where my confusion
was.
Sure. Yes.
No, that makes sense now when you said that. I was like, those are like, I don't know what you're talking about with Went Out American Cusack or whatever.
But that was everything from the last two rounds.
Oh, that's a good chunk. Okay. Yeah. Have you ever seen Gross Point Blank with John Cusack?
I have not.
Yeah, I haven't either. I heard everyone says it's good. Yeah. And I like Minnie Driver. I'll have to see it. It's on my list. It's on the list. All right.
Perhaps you can watch it while hanging out in Milwaukee.
That scene in Wayne's World is when they like, we're backstage with Alice Cooper and he's talking about like, he's like this, like the joke was, he was like this metal guy.
Right.
And he's like giving all these like historical facts and like the Native American stuff. Like that, right? That was the big thing. Yeah. That was pretty funny.
I mean, I hear in real life, Alice Cooper actually is that kind of nerdy guy.
Usually smart.
Right. Yeah.
Entertainers are. Yeah. They really are. Like Colbert, for example.
Yeah.
Yep.
I'm going to take us out to the next part two with Feed My Frankenstein. Feed my Frankenstein. Boom, boom. Okay, now we're going to part two.
Perfect.
That was Alice Cooper's song, people. Feed My Frankenstein. Okay. Let me reset. All right. So, special guest, Mr. Wu.
Hello, hello.
You're taking us to Milwaukee.
Milwaukee.
So, what are we talking about now?
So, This has been big news, especially recently. It's popped back into public consciousness in a big way, right? Mm-hmm. Me personally, I didn't know it went away. But what I want to talk about is Nintendo.
Nintendo.
It's been like the driving force of my life.
Now,
so.
let's expand upon that. I didn't think we talked about we met through comedy, and then we got to know each other more. And
yep.
You're a gamer, and I'm a former gamer. I don't play much, but I really like video games. I love the industry, and I respect it because I feel it's just another creative outlet. Just it's no different from a book or a comic mm-hmm. book or a movie. It's just another form. Well, some video games are like a form of telling a story. Not all.
Yeah.
And some are just...
Right. Some of them tell amazing stories.
Last of Us. Like
awesome. Last of Us?
Yeah. Last of Us, yeah.
We always talked about... Remember we talked about Last of Us like episode 2 and I was just like blown away. That was like one of the last games I played.
Yeah. Good place to quit.
So yeah, why?
It's
never going to get any better.
George Costanza, this shit, the video game, right. Actually, I think the last like full game I played, I brought it up on the show, was Ni No Kuni.
Okay.
Phenomenal game. But I don't get to, I really like a game like that. Like I get to play like once, maybe twice a year now. It's so in depth.
Like even me, like I dedicate time to this. I build a machine that lets me play these things. Like, I'm an enthusiast. I would call myself an enthusiast.
Sure.
And even then, like finding the time to dedicate, I've got like 4 games running right now and none of them are done.
Yeah.
Right. Like I can't bring myself to like just go through and just say, okay, today, another hour. Actually, one of the things I've been trying to do is like...
But does it feel like work to you or does it feel like you want to do it?
Definitely not work because work is work.
Preach.
It does feel like effort. It does feel like I want... I want to sit and enjoy this and absorb the whole thing. So actually, I'm the same way with movies. I'm the same way with TV shows where I can't like put something on in the background that I want to see. I need to like...
Absorb it.
I'm trying to study it as I'm watching it.
And that's a big thing. Like I think, we're a big multitask industry right now. And that's why I think podcasting and podcasts are really hitting the millennials because of the multitask where like so many people, I see so many stories and accounts and posts about this is like so many of these, the young gamers, these teenagers, early 20s, they're playing video games while listening to a podcast.
Right.
Yeah. That's a big thing they're doing. They have like...
Which even that seems like... like a lot to focus on because certain video games like from Bethesda and stuff that I've played, like I'd be hard pressed to be listening to a bunch of people rant and talk and not being able to see the hilarious eyebrow.
You can listen this time.
Not being able to see the hilarious eyebrow movements that I'm doing while trying to focus on killing 6 things.
Right.
Right. Yeah.
But skillfully. I mean, like this is a podcast, so you don't have to watch the video. You can watch the video on YouTube.
Please look at my pretty face.
Please.
Just keep looking at it.
If you please...
Don't stop. Don't ever stop looking at it.
Please people. And please tell your friends...
Just pause it here.
When we get to, I think when I get to 100 on YouTube, I can get my own URL on YouTube. I'm trying to get that 100.
Ooh.
But SoundCloud's been blowing up recently. It's good stuff. It's pretty great. Yeah. So people are listening to it. They're not watching as much on YouTube. But again, my patrons love watching.
I think I got a couple of my current new coworkers on board as well.
Ooh, oh, cool. Great. Yeah. Because the last two, like the preamble's been blowing up, but I think it's the movie thing that people have been doing.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
But the last couple of Brew With You has been getting like double the amount of views recently, which is great.
Awesome.
We've been slowly rising, which is good. Very little. But I monitor.
The fire rises.
Oh, gosh. So we have not talked about Nintendo once.
Yeah.
So let's talk. This happens on the show.
Yeah,
We have fun and
let's
we
spin. Yeah.
So let's go back.
Enter
the
30 lives code, and then we'll just Nintendo.
Right.
Next
So before we continue, Danny.
Yes.
You'll probably have a different answer between Wu and I. But what's the first thing you think of when you think of Nintendo?
Super Mario Brothers and Duck Hunt as a combo game when we first got it.
It's a great answer.
Those are the very first memories of me as a little kid that like actually being old enough to play video games.
For me, it's just very similar. Just the original NES, the NES, if you will. That system. It's my favorite system to this day. I know it's maybe because it's a nostalgia thing, but I think the library alone proves it. And I just love the simplicity of the controller. The only problem, the controller, if it was not just that awkward square, that rectangle.
Yeah.
But I love the simplicity.
The ergonomics.
It's like, some of my favorite games of all time. Like Mega Man 2 is in my top 10.
Oh, yeah.
And that's the original. But what do you think of when you think of Nintendo?
The hundreds of hours of Super Smash Brothers Melee that I play.
Oh, so you're thinking, you're not thinking old school. You're thinking more Melee.
My God.
GameCube. Yeah.
That's
right?
Still like 15 years ago, man.
And that, what is up with this? Maybe you can emphasize this. I'm a big fan of the fighting game community.
Sure. Yeah.
Evo happened not too long ago. If you're not familiar with Evo, look it up. It's the biggest video game, fighting video game tournament in the world, like Mortal Kombat, Street Fighter, where you see like two guys. If for my video game illiterate people, for fans and patrons, it's just like, you know, you see two people fighting each other. That's all it is, just two people fighting. But
it's like Rocky.
I like to consider it like, into my opinion, it's like chess for the 21st century, because you have to know so much. It's not just pushing buttons. You should just try, like I always say, you want to see play a fighting game for an hour, just for an hour. Play a character, see what it's like. Then watch a professional watch a game. It is fucking insane.
It's like watching ballet.
Yeah, for real. It is insane.
I just recently was at Emporium in Logan, and I played my executive kitchen manager in Mortal Kombat. And because
hell yeah, you did.
Because I'm a little older, he's like, yo, crap, you're probably going to know like all the moves and stuff. And I was like, if I can remember them, yes.
Mortal
and
Kombat was all about moves.
It was so hard to try and remember like all the down to back, like forward, like, you know, high kick, not low kick. It's not going to work. And I was just like, I don't remember this stuff. Oh, yeah.
I remember like Sub-Zero's like ice ball and Scorpion's spear, and that's about it.
I could never get beyond, okay, quarter circle punch, quarter circle punch. Okay, I get that.
That's why I was a Street Fighter. I was Street Fighter over Mortal Kombat. I like Mortal Kombat. I liked it, but I thought Street Fighter was more, it invented, had more balance. It
invented combos.
Exactly.
The game invented combos. Yeah, accidentally. It accidentally invented combos, but it invented combos.
So Smash Brothers Melee. That's GameCube, right?
That's the GameCube.
And that was the thing during, like, maybe you can explain this real quick.
Sure.
I'm getting, you know, sidetracked again, but why is Melee still at Evo when we had Brawl after it, and now what's the new one called? Just Wii U.
It's just 4. Yeah Super Smash Brothers 4.
So why is Melee, like 15-year-old game, still at Evo?
I do wonder that too. So it is the game. So definitely why Brawl is not in it. Brawl decided to Mario Kart the thing a little bit. So, you know, Mario Kart, you get your blue shells and just root. Like, I'm doing really well, but a blue shell hits me. Like, that's not fair. It's not skill.
Right.
People complain.
So yeah. Brawl
added a lot. Like, you can trip. That's not a good thing. Like I'm just running, but randomly I can fall down. Like, that's not,
it's a random thing.
Yeah,
oh,
so no, it's not like like I kind of want the skill. Like, they're trying to make it a party game again, kind of.
Oh, like Mario Party. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That's a great game, by the way.
Oh, it's Mario Party, more it's violent. Infuriating game.
I have blisters
on my hand from that, like 1998.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Running my hand in a circle.
Oh, hell yeah. That game, Danny and I remember we played that. I played that with Steve. Steve was a big gamer. That was great when you had four controllers for N64. From Mario Party. That game was, it was like that. This, it was like the closest thing you had to a board game.
Oh,
video games.
Best.
It was
the
so
best.
Fun.
Yeah.
But so Melee.
No, so Melee doesn't have those. It's much more like skill based. There were other things too. So maybe
that's the thing with fighting games. That's why it's more accepted in the fighting community. It's more skill.
We feel like, okay, you do this move and I can counter this with this. You do this move, I can counter this with this. I can time this. I can read what you're doing and attack it.
Yeah.
You know, so this idea that. And so a big thing about it is that people discovered like things that were not intentional, maybe not intentional kind of tricks.
Yeah,
there's a way to move faster.
Like
a way
glitch or not glitch, but like just
so right. Yeah.
Also, interestingly enough, that was pretty much that game was one of the, like the only times where I was like, Pokeballs are important.
That was
because I'm still not really into the Pokemon Go thing because I just never
how
got.
How dare you?
I never got.
How dare you?
I never got into it. I never got into it as a kid. And in that game, I was just like, oh, wait, I throw these things and there's a good chance that they're going to kill everyone.
That
was the thing. Like,
or you'll get a Goldeen.
In tournament play, you don't have any items or anything. It's just like one-on-one fighting. But that's why I love the Melee. That's why the great aspect is like a party game.
Yeah.
And when you have all these items and stuff, I think a lot of people just like, because it's a video game. So like, if you actually played it with a group of people, especially Smash Brothers, it's addicting. And it's fun when you play with people.
Right.
It's so fun. And Nintendo, segueing to the topic.
Hey, we made
that
it back.
I think is what Nintendo has always has done, even to this day, is they are about the people. It's about the friendly play environment, bringing people together and connecting people.
They're a lot like Apple in this regard.
Where
Apple's like, okay,
absolutely,
I don't really care what your opinions are, but trust me, this is gonna be good. Right? Like it's always like, well, you know, you say you want to do it this way. No, you don't want to do it that way. Trust me, this is better. You know, it's like, and you know, it kind of grates on you a little bit because you're like, well, no, I do kind of want to do it. No, but seriously, do it this way.
Yeah.
Nintendo is like that. So like the new system is probably coming out next year. And people are worried about the NX. Yeah.
NX.
People are worried about what it's gonna be, how powerful it's going to be. But like I don't know. I guess I'm a fanboy, right?
So you're a Nintendo fan. So have you had every system?
My first system was an SNES. I think that hit me in like 1992.
So you didn't have an NES?
I didn't have an NES.
Wow.
No. Yeah. I mean that thing was like $600 in 1992. So it's like Oh my god.
Oh my god. Games were always been expensive.
And yeah, games were like $90. Oh, it's crazy. I've had every system since then, I believe.
For Nintendo.
Yeah. Even the handheld. So I didn't have the original Game Boy, the cabbage green.
I still have the original Game Boy somewhere. Yeah. I still got that somewhere.
Four AAA batteries.
I know. I was a Tetris maniac and Ninja Turtles maniac.
I loved the Game Boy so much.
Game Boy was a great system.
Bo Jackson's baseball and football.
What up, Bo? Bo knows Game Boy. Did you have Nintendo systems growing up, Danny?
Yeah. Well,
I know we had a Genesis guy, weren't you?
We had the NES, and then we switched to Genesis. Yes. Yeah.
I always flip-flopped. I had a Nintendo, then I went to Genesis, then I went to GameCube. No, 64.
Okay.
64. So Genesis 64, yeah.
You're flip-flopper.
I'm a flip-flopper.
Flip-flopper.
Always been.
Yeah. Right.
And then the mid-flip-out during mid-generation is when I had a PS2.
Okay. Yeah,
yeah. Then I went to GameCube in that mid-generation. Ah. Yeah. But GameCube was a great system. I don't care what anyone says.
GameCube was an awesome system.
Best controller ever was GameCube.
Yeah. Soft truck?
Hands down, best controller was GameCube.
I would agree with that. I would agree with that.
And that's why you still see it in tournament play.
They brought back there's an adapter for your Wii U so that you can play your GameCube controllers in the new Smash Brothers.
That's awesome.
Like they created this device and printed, you know, thousands of them just for people to play that.
That is amazing.
So Nintendo, we've all known, we've grown up with. And this is your topic. So why has Nintendo been struggling? Let me rephrase. They were struggling for a while, and then Pokemon Go comes out, and then we have like $13 billion in a month or whatever it was, less than that.
I mean, they definitely own like our childhoods. Like, we have nostalgia for these characters.
We do.
We feel...
That's why Smash Bros. Is so successful.
I debated for a little bit on whether I should get the new NX when it comes out, but the answer is, I want the new Mario. I want the new Zelda. Like, I don't know what they are yet. There's no idea what these things could be, but I want them because I know that they're going to be great. I know that they're going to treat them well.
Crack 3. You want another one?
Right? Yeah, sure.
You want to... I don't know. You can hold me to this. But I'm talking about like official lineup. Like, has there really ever been a bad Zelda game? Like, I don't think there ever has been a bad...
Bad, right?
Bad, yeah, no.
I don't think anything has been bad. There have been disappointments. There have been...
Like Skyward Sword was... No. And to many, it was a
You take that back, sir.
I didn't know.
No, a lot of people hated that game.
What you said is a disappointment.
Right.
That was
even company wide decisions people have derided, right? Like people say, well, why did we focus on motion controls? Why did we do? What's this screen all about? Like the Wii U has been a failure. Yeah, they consider it a failure because
it's officially a failure.
They've sold 10 million units while Sony and Microsoft sold like 20 and 40 each. Yeah,
it's really pathetic what Wii U did. And I think the biggest thing though is that. We just said before, like Nintendo was always about bringing people together. Like the Wii U is one of the best-selling consoles of all time. One, because
of
its price.
Yeah, the Wii.
I'm sorry, I said Wii U.
Yeah.
I meant the Wii. I have a Wii that I haven't opened up in years.
Right.
Everyone had it. We had senior citizens using it, like in retirement homes playing, you know, bowling, and everyone just picked up for the gimmick of it, the motion controls. But then, like, it was, but still, it's like one of the worst systems ever. But it was still that message that needs to bring people together.
Yep. Yeah. But it's so funny, too, because every time that I have witnessed and seen and played a Wii U, it was never like an actual game. It was always just like, or not the Wii U, I'm sorry, just the Wii. It was never an actual game. It was always just like the Wii Sports. So like, I'd go to a house party, it'd be a Wii bowling tournament or a Wii golf tournament.
We're going to play some tennis.
Right,
And to be honest, to be fair, those games were fun. I mean, like it was very simple, but it was like, it works and it was fun. But I mean... You know, so you have the Wii, which is Nintendo. It was a very successful console for them. And then the Wii U comes out. And so people understand when they see the Wii U, they see a controller, you wave it in front of the screen. The screen does what you do. Very simple concept, right?
Yep.
Bowling. Oh, that makes sense. Tennis. Now you see the Wii U, it's like there's a screen, then I got a screen in my hand.
Right.
So is this a portable gaming that it's just...
it's so, like, what the, is the name? This? The name is Wii U. That confused a lot of people. Yeah. Like, is this just like an add-on for my Wii? Is it a new thing? Is it a? We don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. Is it a university?
Yeah, Wii University. Get your degree from Wii U University. Yeah.
Major in bowling digitally.
Less lawsuits than Trump University.
Oh, that's another Wii Trump stab. Wii U. Sounds like when you're sneezing and we're like, Wii U!
So something I reflect on is that the Wii U, again, a failure, right?
Sure.
Yeah. The GameCube was also a failure. It sold far less than the PlayStation 2.
Right.
But at the same time, had some of the most beloved games of Nintendo's history.
It was really funny. Let me add on to that. Like, I remember when, during GameCube's run, even though it didn't sell as well, it won like more, I think, Game of the Years than PlayStation, I think. Did.
Resident Evil 4 don't was a GameCube game. Yeah, yeah. Like things, not just Nintendo, right? There's other people's games were on there.
Absolutely. And that's a big thing that... Go ahead.
That was also... the remake of the original, the remastered Resident Evil that I watched you play.
Oh, yes.
Which was... Like
fucking awesome.
That was one of my favorite games growing up, and then you showed me that, and I was just like,
yeah,
that's what joy. That's how you remember that game. It's so good that this is how you remembered this game being played. I remember being so scared of this game. We would come, so this is a weird post Driver's Ed story. We'd go to Driver's Ed at 6 in the morning. We'd go to my friend's friend Brian's place. We'd start Resident Evil. And then in 5 minutes, we'd be like, well, I don't want to play. You play. No, you play. No, you play. And then we'd shut it off. I didn't get anywhere.
Similar story to that, except like my buddy was playing it. Yeah. And I was just like, you know, like this. I was like, I remember it was a pillow he had. He had a throw pillow. His mom like had throw pillows everywhere. And I was holding his throw pillow on the ground. I was just like hugging it like this. Like just like just rocking, like, oh my God, oh my God. Oh my God. That game, that was like, that was the definition of the like survival horror. Like, where like we, like, yes, games are just brought this new level of games where, yes, games can be like a scary movie. Like, we can be experiencing this just like a scary
Which
movie.
Which was awesome.
Yeah, it was amazing. Yeah. It was incredible.
Terrifying.
Yeah.
So Nintendo now, a big thing is, you know, they're not doing so hot. Now, Pokemon Go came out, and they're, they again, they don't own Pokemon Go. They didn't create Pokemon Go, but they own some of the rights, so they're making some money off this. Well, they're making good money off it still.
Yeah. I mean, considering they do no work for it, I mean, that's great.
Exactly. But they're still hurting, and the Wii U really hurt them. And a big thing I've been hearing, and I don't want to hear your guys' opinion on this, is they, you know, they've made two bad consoles in a row. Granted, one sold well, the other one did not sell well at all. Yeah. But overall, they're not good consoles. They weren't. I mean, I'm just
technologically speaking, they definitely step back.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
and were they just not like good consoles overall, or were they just not good consoles in comparison to the competition?
I think that's a big part of it, right? They realize we can't fight Sony and Microsoft on technology. It's impossible.
Right.
Like, we're just...
Yeah, they, especially
consider this.
Sony.
Yeah, consider that Sony and Microsoft both are not games companies. Yeah. Like, you think of Microsoft, you think of Sony, you don't think, oh, they make the Xbox, they make the PlayStation. You think, no, Sony makes everything.
Yeah.
Microsoft makes Windows.
They don't make Spider-Man anymore.
oh, no.
A big thing, I want to hear your opinions on this. A lot of people saying a very smart move for Nintendo to do, and they've been saying this before Pokemon came out, was they should just stay away from the hardware industry. They should just be just making games and like just like or develop their licenses to other
that they the Sega.
Exactly.
Yeah. Sega got out of the game after the Saturn, right? It was a tremendous
Saturn was
flop.
After Dreamcast?
Oh, the Dreamcast. That's right.
Dreamcast
that's
out,
right.
Yeah,
the Dreamcast, yeah. The
Dreamcast,
Saturn was
Dreamcast
also a
was
flop.
A good system, by the way, though.
Yeah.
It was.
Yeah,
it was
people
a,
love
just,
it.
No one's, it didn't sell, but it was a
but
good system.
Yeah. So that's the idea. Like, so I think that's why I'm not afraid of Nintendo going away. They will always have these licenses. They
and
always
t-shirts.
Have these.
And t-shirts. Oh, yep. Yes, I got my. I didn't wear. If you knew it was your tongue, I would have worn my Nintendo shirt. But I got Captain America. So
it's my Metroid shirt. My Space Jump shirt.
Hell yeah!
Actually, I got. It's not actually Nintendo. So. Yeah.
What do you mean? Could have worn the Triforce shirt, but my Triforce shirt is green. So,
I have a favorite shirt of mine.
I didn't even think of that. I didn't even think about it.
Yeah, no, if you did, though, I would say, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to.
We lucked out.
I'll give you a t-shirt. Yeah, I forgot to tell you that, too. Yeah. Why are you talking about green? No. We're in
Milwaukee.
Yes. Oh. Real quick, because I got to mention this so that I can give you some props on the show.
Oh, props.
So coming back from the Museum of Science and Industry today, I stopped with Tiffany, who's in town right now.
What up, Tiff? You made a cameo in like episode 4 or something.
Yeah. who's in town right now. We made a stop at the downtown Chicago Public Library that's right there at John Marshall Law School in Lake Harold, Washington.
Yeah, yeah. All to the thanks to the power of reading.
And the power of reading. So we went up there just to check it out because she's like, oh my God, if you haven't seen this, you need to check it out. They ended up having a history of Chicago beer exhibit. So we're like, oh, let's pop in there real quick. Yeah. Let's see what's going on. Two things that prove we're better than the Chicago Public Library system. They have a video, a digital video that it's a guy who's reading a cue and he's telling stories and histories of beer. He's in front of a green screen. Horrible job. Horrible job. I mean, I'm not even kidding you, dude. There's about a quarter inch of green pixelated around his entire body. Then we go continue on. We're reading some other signs. They're talking about the craft beer boom in Chicago. They have this whole board of Chicago craft breweries. They have Three Floyds as a Chicago brewery. Nope. I took a picture. I'm going to post it to Three Floyds' wall and be like, hey, just so you know, the Chicago Public Library is claiming Three Floyds as an Illinois brewery.
I don't know if I like that or not because it's one, it's a mistake and you're calling them out, which I agree. But second, it's the Chicago Public Library. It's you're picking on the poor little library, man.
That library is 10 stories, okay? if they can't find a guy.
They have a winter garden.
Yeah.
It's a winter garden.
If they can't check their facts on where a brewery comes from.
I'm sorry, Danny. They don't have you. Yeah. Well, that's what you're doing.
I left a comment card. And the comment card said, by the way, Three Floyds is an Indiana brewery, just so you know.
Good for you.
Yeah.
You gotta check back.
Speaking of which, that's we gotta talk about that in the next 2 months. Remember, I brought that up. One of our patrons wants to do our shoot out there. Yes. Do an episode out at Three Floyds.
Munster, Indiana.
That's right. Yeah. That's not far at all.
When's Dark Lord Day? That's past already, right?
That's a good question. I know. Yeah. No, that's not right. Never mind. I'm not going to fix some facts. You can't fix facts or something you don't know. Yeah. So wrapping up Nintendo, Wu,
sure, yeah.
You're a diehard fan.
Yeah.
You're curious about this new NX system. It's possibly going to come out next year. Nintendo's been very weird.
Cagey. Yeah. That's the word I would use. Yeah.
So what are your final thoughts right now on Nintendo and the future or what? How you are as a fan.
I mean, so I'm not a religious man, but I believe in them. I'm not afraid. I feel they're going to come out with the games that I love. I guess I'm a little afraid of new IPs.
Sure.
Right. They're still kind of milking Mario. They're still kind of, everything Zelda is still Zelda, right?
Well, talking about Pokemon, the new Pokemon game.
Right. It's a nostalgia.
It's the same thing. You start off with three. Small increments. It, You know, they did some breakaway with Mario Galaxy 1 and 2, which were phenomenal games.
And even the idea of like Mario Sports, okay, cool. You're making a sports game, but you're kind of putting Mario on it so that people will look at it.
Sure.
Right.
Go ahead.
So there's a little bit of that fear that they're going to stop innovating. But they're just, hey, let's just milk for money. Let's just do that.
It's always been a fear. Yeah, especially now. It's
especially when they gotta make a move. They don't have that win. But I feel good. I feel I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid of what's coming.
And I think whenever a major publisher or developer, they come out with a new console, the whole world's on them. The whole world's on them. When Sony, E3s or PAXs, excuse me, whatever it may be.
People still, Sony and Microsoft still look to Nintendo for ideas.
Sure.
They're looking to see, well, what are they coming up with and how do we make this?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's a good thing.
I got just a quick question because it's on the subject.
Yeah.
A lot of, obviously, nowadays, there's a lot of massive third-party corporations that have their hands in gaming.
Sure.
Would you personally consider Nintendo? I know that Atari came before it, but would you consider Nintendo the start of the gaming industry?
I mean, Atari came before it, and
But was it
Nintendo gave us the story, right? Nintendo gave us.
I have a great analogy.
Yeah.
I have a great analogy. Yeah. I'm sorry to interrupt, but I think
No, the more I learn, the better.
Comic books existed before Superman.
Yeah.
Superman. Though is what we feel like the first superhero, the first really the dawn of the comic book. Nintendo, Mario could be considered that. There was Pac-Man before it and Pong, but Mario,
Donkey Kong on the Atari, let's put a story in a video game. Let's put cutscenes in a video game.
Sure. Yeah. I think that though, like Mario, like, yes, there were some good comics too before Superman, but I'm saying like Superman and Mario have that parallel where like, yes, there was with them, but those two changed the game that literally launched it.
Okay.
My two cents, I made that up on the fly. I don't know.
I liked it. I like it. It made sense to me. That made sense to me.
Cool. All right, let's move on. Good topic, by the way. We haven't talked I like this video game. You know, we actually got into the history.
I think about them a lot. So.
Oh, yeah. Well,
I'm thinking about them right now.
We'll be seeing more of each other soon. I'm not going to allude to anything, but, you and I are in talks for stuff. That's all I'm going to say for now.
Be looking for the Big Deal Blake app.
Yes.
That's a fucking great idea.
I know it is. That's why I get paid the no-bucks.
Big deal app.
No. It's just your face is spinning around for an hour.
Oh, yeah.
That's
right. Dude, I'm going to get a photographer, man, and get some good shots. Some 360 shit right here. VR Blake.
Oh, that's a different topic, and I could talk about that for hours.
VR. I had to do it to you because you do it.
Oh, yes.
Thank you. I always do it, but I said VR. That's why you did it. Okay, good. Touché, my friend. All right, let's move on to topic three.
Yeah,
and we do a little something different because Danny's got a topic, so we're gonna segue this. So hold on.
Sure.
And
action.
Action. Action.
Was that too soon?
No, you're good. I'm not like stopping it. I'm just. No. I have to stop the.
This never stops. It never stops.
I haven't been home in weeks.
Best podcast ever. I'm just gonna tear my eyeballs out, man.
I've just been here recording nonstop for Blake.
You ain't leaving till I get 100 subscribers on YouTube.
Blinking Morse code. Ooh. We will help.
For the love of God, subscribe.
Anyways.
He's feeding me bad potatoes. He's Polish.
He doesn't know how to make enchiladas.
Miss you, Mom.
A single tear.
Yes, yes.
Anyways, so I think the topic kind of segues of Nintendo segues really great into it because just lately Blake has been struggling with Snapchat.
I don't fucking get it. Now, you know what's worse? I work with a young lady. She's 23. It's adorable. She's so young. And,
who's doing this all the time?
Not well. She's on her phone all the time, but not like that. Not selfieing.
Okay.
And she's like, she was trying, and I was talking to her about Snapchat, and she's like, "Oh, I think it's just a generational thing." And I'm like, "Oh, okay. That's how it is. Okay, that's how it is. That's how it is. All right.
We're technically both millennials, but you're not in my generational league.
We are technically all millennials. Yeah. I'm just saying. But we
started the millennial thing.
We did. So yeah, Snapchat. Please, so I interrupted, but Snapchat. I'm not saying fuck Snapchat. I'm not saying that. It's just like,
that's a different app.
It's yeah.
Yeah.
They call that Tinder.
Think Nintendo's gonna jump into that market?
They started there. So.
The gaming dating market. That would be awesome.
Oh God, yes. Yeah.
Mario, you're with Kirby. Wait a minute, that can't happen.
Big deal app. Big deal app. But no, okay. So, kind of talking about that, it's a very funny concept to me. I use it. I use it quite a bit. But even now, like you also just jumped back into Instagram at Big Deal Blake on Instagram.
I retired for 5-6 years. Came back 5 years. I say 5.
And
years
I just found it hilarious because the moment that you get back into Instagram and you're texting me about Snapchat and you're like, "What is the point of this app?" Instagram then launches its own Snapchat feature. And I looked into it today, and they basically like Meliana trumped Snapchat. Like, if you look at the updates in Instagram, it literally is the description of what Snapchat stories are, but they call it Instagram stories. And so now on Instagram, you can, instead of taking a photo that just stays on your account, you can take a quick photo or video, edit it in the exact same way that you edit a Snapchat, and it stays for 24 hours and then disappears off of your account. So literally Instagram was just like, fuck you, Snapchat. We're just going to do the exact same thing and make it a thing on people's profiles.
So you're saying that Instagram is Sony and Snapchat is Nintendo.
That sounds right. Yeah, right. We gotta take this.
But it all kind of segues.
Well, I mean, I think that's very fair. I see where you're going already. Is that, you know, you see that right now with Facebook. It took things from Twitter from Facebook.
Yep.
That was going on for a while, and now it's all intermingling. Like going live now, it's like you see it on Twitter and Facebook, and now I don't know. It's just
even something that just popped in my head now is how Facebook did not used to have the feed. Right. You didn't have status updates. It was just your wall. That was it.
That was it.
They just stole that straight from Twitter. That was just Twitter.
Sure. That's good. That's a great point. That was on the right. Yeah, but it was an escalation. It's all escalation. Like they do this, they copy it, but make it a little bit better because they started it first, and then they add something. It's just this back and forth and upping the copying, if you want to, like copy and mutating to something that I can't even fathom. Fuck you, Zuckerberg.
I mean, it all leads to robots, of course.
Yes.
It all leads to robots.
So please continue.
That will eventually take over the world.
Yes.
Skynet.
But yes, definitely Skynet. Still live in fear of that, kind of. Not really, but a tiny bit. Anyways.
Skynet zombies.
Anyways, what that and coming in line with Nintendo and just talking about like that quick blurb about the technology issues that you're having with these apps today that are so popular with the kids. I kind of wanted to talk about, and we've talked about plenty of things from our youth, but trends with kids today versus trends when we were kids.
Okay.
I mean,
so we need an example. Give me an
example.
So
it's, well, that's one right there, right? When, and this is, God, this is really dating me, but when I was a kid, and I mean like
that was like 37 years ago. You're 1932, not right, Daddy?
Bill Cosby. Yes.
If he sounds like that, don't go near him. Back in '06.
I'm not doing it.
When I was wearing an onion on my belt, as was the style at the time.
Yes.
We had to use the term bees for quarters because the Kaiser had stole our word for quarter.
Highly dubious.
Give me 5 bees for a quarter, they used to say.
If you're watching or listening and you got that, you're the coolest person in the world.
Give me 5 bees for a quarter.
I can't even believe I'm going to say this, and I hate saying it, but when I was a kid in grade school.
Before you do that, I just want to say it's brave. This is the whole point of a podcast is like... Yeah. You have to open up.
Sure.
You have to reveal some things about yourself that is true and honest. And sometimes it's like, whatever, but...
Tell me all your secrets.
I'm still
Tell
hip.
Me all of them.
I'm still with it. Back when I was in grade school, I don't know, and Blake, I don't know about you, and Wu, are you younger than us? Are you what?
I just turned 30.
So you're in our bracket.
I have just entered your bracket.
Yes. Welcome.
That's like super ballpark. Like, that's close.
But when I was in like 7th and 8th grade, like a big fad, like cool thing to do was to have a pager on you.
The page. Now.
But nowadays, kids definitely have cell phones.
Yes.
And kids can definitely Snapchat each other.
Yeah.
And like that to me is... So weird.
Can you imagine that if you were 12 years old and you were Snapchatting right now?
Weird.
Imagine how much harder it was to sext back then.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, I had to do so many crayon boxes. Got used up.
Really
God.
Good detailed ASCII art.
If the girl needed me to know that I needed to be there, it was the 911 text. It was the 911 page, and I was just like, "Oh shit, a 911 page, guys! I got to get to the closest payphone." Yes.
Anyone have any quarters?
Can somebody lend me 2 Bs so I can make that call? And calling collect, that was another
one. Yes.
My dad got so pissed off when I used collect. He's like, it costs like $3 for this phone call, god damn it. And then every time, so when you would call, dial 100 with collect, you dial the number, and then you say like, do you accept, you know, who do you want to call? I'm gonna call my dad. I'm like, say your name after the tone, Blake. And then when you call them, they say, they have a recording like, so-and-so, did they accept this call? And then you hear the person's voice, and it's always my dad going, yes, I accept this call.
I'm like, and you're just on the other side.
God.
This is Greg. Last name, We Had a Baby Eats a Boy.
Yes. 1-800-COLLECT, one of the greatest commercials of all time.
Oh, God.
1010-220.
David Spade. Danny, when we were in high school, what do you think the percentage was? Let's just say our class alone. I don't want to say the whole school, but our class alone, what was the percentage of us senior year, let's say, even senior year having cell phones?
Senior year
having cell phones.
Oh, man. I would safely say like 80.
I didn't have a cell phone senior year.
You didn't?
Nope.
How did I ever get a hold of you?
I don't know. That's so weird. I think it was like you called me on Sunday like, hey, can Blake come out to play? And like, Blake, phone for you. And then I get the phone. I'm like, hey, Danny, what are we going to Dunkin' Donuts? Okay.
I mean, definitely in my class, I was the cell phone guy. So like my friend's parents had my cell phone number because like, hey, you guys are all out together. So I'm going to call you when I need them to come home. Mm. Right? I'm the cell phone. Made me really popular.
I had a phone. Yeah, go ahead.
No, I was gonna say, and I had played that one as well. I'd played that role as well, where I was like, and it would only be when, before I got my own cell phone, which was like, I remember how big of a deal it was, and it was one of those things where my parents were just like, you need to be really careful with this, and you better not be just using this as a regular phone line. This is for emergencies. This is
right. I'm going to call all my bitches. Yeah.
Because back then, you know, the cell minutes were probably like $42.50 a minute or something like that.
Long distance calls, Dan. Yeah. Remember those? That would actually cost you something.
That was a thing.
You know, you have to call after 8, you know, and if you're going to call California.
Now I can iMessage Joe in Ireland for free because it's iMessage.
It's fucking crazy. Yeah. It's fucking insane.
But... yeah, I remember that, and it used to be a big issue because it would be like, well, all right, I do have a phone, but it's to call my parents for when the game is done, you know, right. Blah blah. Yeah. And at certain points in times, like some kids would be like, can we borrow that so we can call our parents?
I think that's really what I did. I borrowed your phone sometimes, and that's actually too a time when you remember phone numbers. Remember when you actually remembered phone numbers? You actually asked for someone's number, and you would never forget it, or
because you had like 6 of them in your head, and that was it.
Actually, you had so many phone numbers.
Now there's like 400 contacts in my phone, and I'm like, that's Blake. He's my best friend. What's his number? I don't know.
I don't remember. I don't know your cell phone. And mine hasn't changed forever. I don't know your cell phone by heart.
Yours is still 890.
Don't say it. What are you doing?
I'm not going to say it, but I know that it's still the 890 number.
Yes, that is correct.
Yeah. Do you guys find, like, I found this happening a lot where I don't know people's phone numbers anymore, but I have their Facebook. So I message them on Facebook. I know they're, like I could talk to them other ways. Like I don't, I guess iMessage is kind of that way, whereas, like, you don't really know their number, right? You just, it's not. It's texting,
just
it's just a contact. Yeah, it's your name. This is I'm
there's
talking
no numbers.
To you by
you're
this
right.
Thing.
That's a good point.
Actually, Google Hangouts, right? Like that idea. Yeah.
Google Hangouts, love it.
You know, it's so funny. We bitched about it that one time.
Yeah, has it worked ever since?
Yep. Ever since we bitched about it, like Google heard us. Google heard us somehow.
They
like,
listened.
I'm telling you,
someone's Hangouts not working to the Google machine, and then bring, and then all of a sudden, like Jeff and I can app. We do that all the time now. It's 0 points. All
right, so I can safely just switch over to Hangouts with you because you'll get the notifications.
Absolutely.
All right.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. So more often than not, I text you because I'm like, maybe Blake.
No, I get them now. No, I get them 100% now. I think the only time now, I actually tell you, who's the other one who I hang out all the time?
Yeah.
I hang out with Jeff, you two, and a few others. I'm not going to name them, but yeah.
Google knows their names.
Google knows them. Yeah. Google knows. I hear all. No. Again. So trends that kids are doing that. Like we did, like similar, like are you talking, is it like a parallel you're talking about or?
No, just the harsh, stark, like contrasts is it's so, I mean, it's, and it's all.
Say, like, for phones is the big one. So
for the, for the most part, phones is the big one, but for the most part, it's a lot of technology driven stuff. Like, do you guys remember when Razor scooters became a thing?
Yes.
I had one stolen.
I still have like a sore on my shin from when I'm like, I could do a flip. No, it goes right into my shin and it hurts forever. It hurts for the next 20 years.
My shin.
And like today, you're going to start seeing a bunch of kids on boosted boards, which is like a remote control, like motor powered skateboard. And it's just like things like that. Even these hoverboards.
The hoverboard,
are blowing up people.
These quote unquote hoverboards that don't really.
I hate that fucking name because it's not a fucking hoverboard.
It's not a hoverboard.
It's a fucking little board with wheels. Don't fucking
marketing,
call it
man. Marketing works.
Michael J. Fox is mad at you.
Yes.
God damn it.
Yes.
It's not a hoverboard, okay? So besides, like, technology is the big one.
Right.
Like, the cell phones, apps, it's like, it's all kind of connected, in my opinion, because our phone is connected to everything.
Yep.
And our bank accounts, our email, our...
they know everything about you.
We have bank accounts in which we don't have to go to the bank and ask them how much money I have.
Yeah. What about like, like there's a thing that I think of typing, for example. Like it took us, for me, like I learned typing young, but I'm like, I feel like babies learn typing out of the womb now. It's like Jesus. I mean, they put
a keyboard in there.
Put it up in there.
And that's another great one though, right? Because when we learned typing, we had like typing classes.
Yes.
The home keys.
The little brown fox jumped over. Yep. No, the little red fox jumped over the brown dog.
And it was like, how many words can you type per minute?
What was it called?
But the quick brown fox.
The quick brown fox.
Yeah.
Honestly, I think that kids are going to learn to type with two thumbs now.
Yes.
Yeah. My,
that'd be funny on a keyboard.
Yeah.
Swipe's not working. My finger hurts.
It's running it across.
Oh, that's
awesome. That is awesome.
But that, I mean, that's a scary thing too, because my nephew is 2 years old. Mm. You put an iPhone or iPad in his hand, and he already knows to swipe and push things.
Coming
like,
from your family, yep. I figured he would eat it. But I'm just kidding.
Well, he hasn't selected anything that's pictures of food, so I don't know. Yeah,
gotcha.
I still haven't met little Tony.
Little Tony.
Little tea time.
But that's another one. I mean, it's just weird. Like things that we learned when we were kids that were like imperative skills.
Don't get in band with strangers.
Right. Yeah.
No. Yeah. Yeah, strangers was don't do drugs. Remember, because we
Dare. Remember Dare?
Dare was
yes.
Huge. Oh, Dare was big. God, so many Dare shirts. Dare was a big one.
Now I assume they tell kids to do drugs.
Do they still? Yeah. All the kids are doing drugs now because they have the apps and they just app their drug friend.
I'm on the oxycodone. Yeah.
Cocaine. And they hook up these fifth graders with cocaine because of an app. Thank you, iPhone. I'm trying to think. You know, like technology is everything right now. And it moves so goddamn fast right now. It's so fast. I mean, Facebook, what is... a little over 10 years old now?
2004, maybe?
Yeah, I would say four or five. I was about to say five. Yeah. But five is definitely YouTube. Yeah.
No, YouTube's like 2007.
No. No, 2005.
Really?
YouTube's over 10 years old.
Is it? Oh, yeah, that's right. They had their 10. That's right. But it was really recent. Yeah.
Yeah, it's. Oh. I mean, but you think about like YouTube, the empire it is now.
Yeah, no, it wasn't that.
Please continue. I have to write this down because I remember this at the top. It's about YouTube.
Okay.
I have to write this down or I'm going to forget.
I mean, the one thing so that I remember most or that I was thinking as the concept of offline. Like what there is no more concept of offline. We're never offline. We're always connected. Before, offline was literally, I need to shut this off or I can't get phone calls.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. No, that's, I mean, computers. I mean, again, it's a lot of technology based stuff, but that kind of spurns something much bigger, which is prior to being online, what did you guys do? I used to go to arcades as a kid.
Oh.
I used to go to arcades.
I wrote an article one time, and I submitted it to IGN. I was a college kid, and you can't blame me for trying, right?
No, absolutely.
And actually, it was a good article, and I got a lot of compliments on it. And it was about the what happened to the arcade.
Yep.
Like what the arcade that would exist now is one of really two things. This is his own topic, but it's like the mini arcade in a movie theater.
Mm-hmm.
Or like the gimmick arcade we see at like the Emporium here in Chicago.
Or the Dave and Buster's.
Exactly.
Or
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's like, there's not like the arcade anymore.
Yeah.
There's another topic though. The arcade was someplace very special. And they don't, you know, with, fuck you Pokemon Go, because I have arcade everywhere I go now. But we have, you know, like we have games on our phone. Anything. The only thing we can't do on our goddamn phones is do our laundry, which I wouldn't be opposed of if we could do our laundry.
There is
on our
a service. There is a service that you. It's
put it in my phone.
It's the Uber of doing laundry. You hit a button, someone comes and picks up your laundry and does your laundry for you, and then gives you back your laundry when it's clean.
What's it called?
I don't know. I'm like morally opposed to that for some reason.
That's the thing I'm worried about. It's like how much money. Like, there's so many services now, but, like, how much money can we have that we can't just, like, do something ourselves? And I think that's the thing that segues into what Danny's talking about, is that with all these technology and the kids we're doing, that are kids working, are kids getting jobs early? Are we telling these 13? My first job was I was 13. Are kids mowing the lawns? Are they learning to do that? Or are they always on their phones and just realize I just, you know, can just do everything with an app?
Right.
I don't know.
No.
I learned hard work growing up.
And okay, yeah, no, and we can absolutely move forward at that point because I was the same way. Like when I was growing up, fashion trends is an entirely new, a different one. Fashion trends were super different when we were kids.
A Deadpool shirt, a Metroid shirt, and a Captain America shirt.
We are grown men. We are grown men.
Grown ass men.
But do you guys remember when we were kids what fashion trends were like?
Not a clue.
Big time.
Yeah.
I have no clue. I don't remember. I can't picture it.
The first thing that comes to mind is early 90s, the grunge age with Nirvana, the flannel.
Okay.
The grunge age,
but do you remember the super baggy jeans?
Oh, sure.
The JNCOs?
Yeah.
They're coming back.
Yeah,
no. You can live in them.
No.
It's like a tent for your legs.
It's a camping trip everywhere. Yay! I go.
That's good.
Sadly enough, part of
Airwalkers.
Like, Airwalks?
Airwalks.
Airwalks, the skating shoes.
Walkers.
I remember the pumps, like you had the little thing.
Doc Martens.
Doc Martens. That was a minor trend. They still have those around, don't they?
Yeah.
They're still around, yeah.
Those are, I think, gaining popularity again.
Right, yeah.
But I never owned a pair. Fashion fashion trends are definitely one that were just way different when we were kids versus what we see now.
But that's also, too, that's different when we were kids versus then. The 70s, 60s, 50s.
No.
That's a big thing. I want to talk about that, too. God, a lot of good topic conversations.
What's
our style now? Like, you look back, 90s really had two really, like, loud fashions. Mm. 80s had a loud fashion.
Yeah.
70s, 60s, 50s, 40s. Now it's like, what's like when you look at like the 2010s?
What was the 2000s?
The hell we're in right now?
What was the 2000s?
Exactly.
Like, I have no idea.
It's like a blur. I don't know. A blend. I don't know what the hell.
I mean,
it
was. 2000s rock and roll consisted of John Mayer and Maroon 5.
God help us.
Like, what is that decade?
God help us.
what happened?
That is Wonderland. God, what? I never understood. Why was he so.
I gotta say, I saw John Mayer live once on Conan, and he's an amazing blues guitarist.
Oh, no, so no.
Respect for
I've
that.
I've always heard he's an amazing guitarist.
He really is. Yeah. He really is.
But I just never could get on board.
And I'm I agree.
No, I don't hate him. It's just like, cool, I'm not gonna listen to you. Done. Yes. All right, moving on. Yeah. I'm gonna go download my YouTube Red and listen to something that's not you. Like Mike Snow. It's a band. It's called Mike Snow. You know
Mike
that?
Snow, yeah.
But they're a Swedish band. They have two I's in their name. It's an inside joke right now. I'm winking at people. It's called I got like six of their Swedish band. It's like two eyes. So I go, Maca Snow. It's Maca Snow. I've been saying it for a week now. It's pretty great.
All right.
Maca Snow.
I mean, this is going to burrow its way into my head somewhere. And
it's an inside
pop out
joke
and
that
like,
I shared with
what?
You. So
okay.
I'm going to get in your head. Maca Snow. I'm listening to Maca Snow.
When you say inside joke, is it you're just trying to get it inside of our head?
Right. It's burrow. It's like nesting.
Double
right now.
Meaning. Double meaning. All right, so that's a good topic, Danny.
It's just weird. And I mean, it's to me, like, you can verse it any way you want. Media is absolutely another one. You know, the music that came out when we were young versus the music that comes out now. Like,
yeah, is that like, I mean, it's, but I think that's just an ongoing thing because, like, I said,
evolution.
Like, yeah, I mean, like,
I think
yeah.
it's a, I think it's a fracture. I think
so
it's a fracture.
Society revolution.
So think like when we were growing up, there were. Like, I wouldn't say there were four channels on the TV, you know, with cable, but there were really only
Turn that dial.
Oh, yeah. What is a dial? Please explain what a dial is.
Yeah. Does this.
I just stand up and change the channel with a little knob.
You always had to put it for three for video games. That's what I remember.
Oh, yeah. Yes. And you had to worry about the VHF versus the UHF.
That's
that was
right.
a big deal. Now, so,
oh, no.
So, like
beta.
You know, like, yes. So, like 10 years before us, like, there were only like four channels on TV. That was it.
Yeah.
You know, by our time, there were still only a few. That was the beginning of cable. It was only a few outlets for media. So, everybody was kind of on the same page. Everybody saw the same shows.
Yeah.
Everybody heard the same
TGIF,
music.
Everybody.
Right. Yeah, we got... there was one that took place in Milwaukee.
Milwaukee?
It took place after the Urkel show. But... I can't remember the shape.
Family Matters was Urkel. That was in Chicago, though.
Right. They had the one crossover episode where Steve Urkel rode a jetpack. And at the end of his episode, he flew up into the air and didn't land. But in the beginning of the next show, he landed right in their living room. This is the things that are in my brain.
Was it step by step?
I think so.
Day by day.
Yes.
Everywhere.
So
people everywhere.
So like, there's no way today that you'd turn on the TV. It's a Friday night. I'm watching these shows, and all of us will talk about it on Monday morning. It's never gonna happen. No. We get one at best.
Well, you know the funny thing is, like, my roommate Johnny, he works. He's on his feet. He works. He's a blue collar guy. Works all day, and then he you know, he watches a shitload of TV when he comes home because he's, sure. he's working literally on, hands-on labor 12 hours a day. So he just watches TV. And he's watching show after show after show after show. And he's like, you watch this, you watch this. I'm like, no, like there's so much shit out there. And I mean shit, I mean not negatively.
Quantity.
Just, there's so much out there. And then everyone talks. And it's like, the big hot topic right now is Stranger Things. That's the show that everyone's talking about. Everyone's, I haven't watched it yet.
On Netflix. Yes, check it out.
But I haven't got to it yet because...
That was the first thing that popped in my head when you said earlier that you can't multitask certain shows. Like you have to pay attention to them. And like I tried doing some stuff around watching an episode, and then I watched it again, and I was like, "How did I miss all that?"
Yeah.
Good topic, Danny.
I like topics that are good.
Now when you were gone, I rated some beers first today,
sure,
Danny, and you had a lot of time to process this. So give us your rating of Green Flash's Tangerine IPA, or Soul Style IPA, I should say.
A what style?
Soul style.
Train mass transit system. I like this beer. It's refreshing. It did what I expected it to do in a West Coast IPA, which it's weird to say, but traditionally the characteristic of them is that they're over hopped, and it's you lose a little bit of that balance in the maltiness versus the hop characteristics of the beer. The sweet to me all came from the taste of tangerine. As I told you guys earlier, I really just feel like somebody pinned me down and squeezed a tangerine into my mouth while like in the very front of my tongue while I was tasting this. But on the back end, it's very much that kind of pine, like just very kind of earthy, like finish that it was very bitter to me. It's kind of an interesting twist to have it start completely.
What a twist.
To start completely one way versus to finish completely a different way. It's drinkable.
Yes, it is.
In saying that, I mean, like, I could have a couple of these for sure. Yep.
You're like the John Steinbeck of rating. What are you giving it?
I like it, but I would probably say it's not blowing me away. I'd give it a 3.
Okay.
Oh. Yeah.
Woo.
So I really like IPAs. I've actually been staying away from them for a little bit.
That?
I don't know. Like at some point I realized I just was just going for bitterer and bitterer. That's not a word, but bitterer and bitterer.
Yeah. We make up words on the show, and then Webster's like, "Oh, damn, it's a good word."
We wordify.
Wordify.
Yeah,
it's a perfectly cromulent word.
Embiggen. Embiggen. So. Yeah, I noticed I was trending toward that, and I'm like, I don't really want to do that anymore. So I backed off. But I don't really taste the bitter on this. I just taste the sweet and just feel like this is a good IPA, and I like the tangerine sweetness.
Wow.
And it, like, the blend feels perfect. Like, it feels like it's, like, that hoppy bitterness and tangerine seem to, like, go hand in hand. Like, they've met in my mouth, and they've said, good deal.
There's a party in my mouth, and everyone's invited.
So I feel like this is a great summer beer for me. Like, absolutely. I would love summer to sit beer on a porch and just drink a few of these.
And I got a porch, but if I should have got a second pack, so we could go on the porch.
I really like this. I would give this a 4 or 4.5 for me. Yeah.
Whoa,
So 4. I mean, I've been drinking this faster than you guys. So
no, I'm on the same pace as you.
Buddy. Yeah.
I'm actually this is very interesting. I'm in between you two. I agree with both of you. I feel that it's a solid IPA. I agree more on Danny's side that I love the balance. Well, first of all, with what we were saying, that I love the balance of the IPA and the tangerine. You could definitely taste the tangerine, definitely IPA, but I think I agree on Danny's side, thinking that the bitterness at the end, it's high. There is some intensity at the end, and you definitely taste it, like, really in the front of your mouth is the best way. You really, really feel that residue. So I'm giving it 3.5. Solid score, and that's a good beer, and I'll definitely keep my eye on this. I'm curious now what the passion fruit and their standard, just their straight up IPA will taste like now. Very curious. So 3.5
side by side. Side by side them at some point.
Yeah. Try that. We'll do a beer tasting. I wanted to do that for several things, like pale ales and IPAs and like side by side comparison.
One
we
of
have
these
Coke Pepsi test? No, we don't beer test.
One of these is bleach.
I'm not telling you which one the antidote is. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us for episode 45 of A Brew With You. I have been one of your hosts, Big Deal Blake. You can find me, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, SoundCloud. And you're watching on YouTube right now, probably.
Tinder.
But most importantly, patreon.com/bigdealblake to get this episode
and
a week early, along with your exclusive content and perks. Danny, where can the lovely people find you?
You can find me at Danny A. Barajas on Twitter and at Danny Adam B. on Instagram.
We're Instagram buddies now.
Yeah.
Yeah. How am I doing on Instagram? What do you think?
We'll talk about it.
This is just payback for all the shit I was talking about in the last month. That's all.
Yeah. Don't stop posting food pictures.
I posted two. Two! Posted Kuma's Burgers with Woo, by the way.
That was a good
day. And then I posted a gin and tonic. That's it. I posted a picture of my boss today. I drew a picture of my boss and I posted it. The creative exercise was I had to draw, it was like a company exercise. I had to draw the person next to me, which happened to be my boss, without looking at the paper. Just had to draw him by looking at him. I don't know why, but that was creative exercise. Woo, if you feel like sharing, where can people find you?
I'm at WooFire on Twitter.
WooFire?
I've had that name since like 1995. It's amazing. Yeah, amazing.
It's awesome.
I'm at WooFire most places, but yeah, at Twitter.
Twitch?
Twitch is WooFire _ on air because I couldn't get WooFire.
Oh, so I got it before in 1993 then.
Yeah, no, that's, you got to go early. You got to go early. Right. Yeah. No, I play a lot of weird games. So
Yeah,
take a look. Yeah.
Yeah, check out Twitch, guys. Yeah. That's my next goal, is to get on Twitch. Mm. And that's my next the next step, because I'm on everything else for now. I moved on to Instagram.
Yep.
And now I'm going back to Instagram, and now I got to move on to Twitch. And,
yeah.
So thank you everyone for joining us. This is how I'm going to end the shows now, I feel. I was thinking about the closer now, and I thought about long. It took me about 3 months to think of a closing. And it's more serious, but I think it's important. And it's people have been awesome recently, and I just want to... I like to end it like this. So thank you for watching. Thank you for sharing. Thank you for subscribing. And most importantly, thank you for telling a friend. We'll have a special guest next time. Again, as an inside joke, not inside joke, but Danny and I were talking about, we need to get a lady on the show, and then we get Woo. Yeah.
I am very effeminate. Thank you.
You're the man, and you're the man, and let's get a woman show. And then like, hey, Woo, you're available? I was like, oh, yeah.
My hair is pretty long, so I mean, I get the
beautiful
confusion.
Beautiful long hair.
The lady at Six Flags once told me, hey, ma'am, come on over.
The lady at Six Flags. Thank you again.
Did you
for
respond
joining
with?
Us.
Thank you
yes,
very much
sir.
For having me. Yes, sir. Yes. Absolutely.
Thank you for joining us.
No,
again.
Thank you for having me. This was wonderful.
We'll like to have you back on.
Oh, and, sure.
We're going to be posting this everywhere. Yep. So it'll be great.
All over.
All right. Thank you, everyone, and we'll see you next time.